Hello, everybody, and welcome to this week's edition of Mid-South Wrestling Television. I'm your host, Boyd Pearson. We'll have a lot of exciting action right here to show you. Not only that, but we're going to show you something really interesting. Great, great matches direct from the Superdome in New Orleans, Louisiana to Extravaganza. A man to tell you about it, Cowboy Bill Watts. Bill?
Well, Boyd, I know you always enjoy going to the Superdome. I think anybody that's not seen it has missed a tremendous situation. And, of course, we had 20,141 people for the largest crowd ever in an April Superdome. And Greg Soley, the son of Gordon Soley, the Atlanta commentator, shot some tremendous footage. He put some to music about people coming to the Superdome just at dusk, just as the sun was going down and people were starting to turn their car lights on. Let's watch that now.
I think that was simply fantastic, and I know you enjoyed it. And we'll go direct to Superdome action right after this word from Mid-South Wrestling Television Network.
Well, some things happened in this Superdome that have never happened before. First of all, there was new Mid-South Tag Team Champions crowned 3 days before the Dome. The match was changed at the Dome, and they were forced to defend their titles. And then, for the first time ever in the history of wrestling, there was an unadvertised steel cage match. This has never happened, that they've had a steel cage match without it being advertised. It was like a bonus that nobody knew was going to happen in the Superdome. Let's see how that transpired as we watch, first of all, the Mid-South Tag Team Champions defend their titles. Here we see the Valiant Warriors in this tag team title match making their way to the ring, and Boyd Pierce.
Their opponents, the champions, You saw the introductions of this Mid-South Tag Team title bout. An intense battle, and I will admit, there is some justification to what Akbar says, and the fact that the new champions, DiBiase and Olympia, won those titles on April the 13th, when Akbar put that $25,000 up and enticed Tiger Conway Jr. and Mr. Wrestling 2 into the match. And here it is, the 16th of April, and they're forced into defending them in the Superdome. And legally, Akbar is right. They didn't have to defend them again for another 30 days. The Mid-South representative said they had advertised it as a title bout in the Superdome, and being it was the biggest wrestling event in the world today, and definitely they wanted the fans to get the event that they had signed to and paid to get. Now, of course, the match that was signed was DiBiase and the Ninja against Two and Conway. So there was a little bit of smooth talking or fast action going on here, I believe. But I think also Akbar's been well known for the pressure and the fast action he puts on people. And so turnabout's fair play. And this will force Mr. Olympia to have to wrestle twice in the Superdome in this defense of the Mid-South Tag Team titles and also in his quest for the North American title, which has been held up along with the $10,000 prize as he faces Junkyard Dog in what became the first time ever in history to be an unadvertised steel cage match. So I think Mid-South has finally said, hey, we're tired of some of these shenanigans. We're going to try to hopefully get some people some fair one-on-one situations. Tiger Conway, probably the best athlete in the ring at this point in time, a tremendous athlete. He and Wrestling 2 have been a great tag team combination. Wrestling 2, the living legend, one of the men that pound for pound has the toughest heart in the world, just won't give up. And they're really taking it to Ted DiBiase and Mr. Olympia. And you're going to see Mr. Olympia really sustain a beating in this match. This match, were you to have to wrestle it once and then have two or three days off to recover, is a tremendously grueling hard match. But he had to go right back in an unadvertised steel cage match. Look at Mr. Two come in after him. But of course, we'll recall that many people have tried to put the Junkyard Dog in the same situation, and he has risen to that occasion numerous times in the past. You see Mr. Olympia, they're really working on him. It's almost like Two and Tiger Conway are joining with everybody. Right there, that tremendous knee lift. It must have jarred him all the way to his molars. DiBiase really protesting it. And of course, Conway has his personal score to settle with DiBiase anyway. Power slam off the top rope. And there you see the living legend. These are, again, are edited highlights. This match went some 25 minutes. And of course, Olympia's calling for timeout there, but Wrestling 2 is not the kind to give any quarter, nor ever to ask any quarter. It's almost like Two and Conway are trying to take some fire out of Mr. Olympia for the Junkyard Dog after that raw deal he got March 21st in New Orleans when Akbar and Olympia, with the help of the Ninja, tried to beat JYD for that North American title, which created a landmark decision by Mid-South Wrestling. When they reviewed the film, they didn't reverse the action because of the decision, but because of the fact the Junkyard Dog was flat on his face, therefore his shoulders could not have been pinned. Olympia is a great athlete. DiBiase, a great athlete. These men, these are a well-experienced crew in the ring right now, and they're going for it in front of over 20,100 people at the Superdome, paying as high as $25 for those ringside special edition seats, all the way down to $5 in general admission. A great scope, a great cross-segment of the wrestling fans getting to see this event. And you watch Tiger Conway Jr., and he is not, he's just fast. There he goes. Right there, going to try to give Mr. Olympia a Charlie horse as he drops inside the leg there, stretching that inside thigh muscles to their fullest extent. And Mr. Olympia, again, a great athlete. There, Conway went for his victory roll. Look how strong Olympia is. He is so powerful, he stopped Conway's down momentum, which would have whipped him forward on his head, and he turned Conway back up, lifted him over, and dropped his throat on that top cable. And those are steel cables inside that rubber coating, and Conway's wind is just gone. He's gasping. And let me tell you, when you're tired and been going hard in a strenuous physical contest, It's hard enough to get air, get wind. That's what makes your motors go. Then to have somebody drop it in, you almost feel like crying, except you can't get enough air in even to cry. And now Olympia dropping in with that sleeper that cuts the blood off through the carotid arteries to the brain. It also squeezes that air even tighter. And this will show you what kind of heart Tiger Conway has as Mr. Wrestling 2, the living legend, screaming, trying to get him to come on, and Conway's reaching down into that something that all great athletes have. That's the difference in the never was Bens or the also Rans and the guys that are the top men. And look, Conway still being able to strategize his way out and break Mr. Olympia's hold. And DiBiase starting in and Wrestling 2, who's always at a low ball, firing in. Neither one of them legal in the ring. And the referee, Rick Farrar, trying to stop that Akbar up. Conway pops him. A lot of confusion at this point. Conway dropping down. Olympia going for the drop kick. Conway sitting into the Boston Crab. Rick Farrar taking Wrestling 2 out of the ring. DiBiase loading up. He loaded up. And he knocked Conway's lights out. Of course, Rick Farrar, from putting two out, turns back around, out of position with all that action. Starts to give both men a 10 count to see who gets to the feet. He doesn't know what's caused Tiger Conway to be in a comatose position. Starts the count. Olympia reaches over, wraps it up, puts a sleeper on him. And then the only options the referee has is to check him to see if he is unconscious or has the ability to continue. And as you see, Tiger Conway is definitely unconscious, but not from the sleeper. And there they retain the Mid-South Tag Team titles, Mr. Olympia and Ted DiBiase. But Olympia spent a lot of tremendous energy in that battle to retain those crowds. There you see a fallen warrior, a man knocked cold by Ted DiBiase and not the sleeper.
You viewed the championship match direct from the Superdome, and that leaves Ted DiBiase and Mr. Olympia still the Mid-South Tag Team Champions after their match against Mr. Wrestling 2 and Tiger Conway Jr. We still have more action coming up. Watch along with us right after this word from Mid-South Wrestling.
Well, DiBiase's association with Skandar Akbar and Mr. Olympia may be the beginning of the end for the Rat Pack, because one very independent, outspoken member apparently is not going to follow the Big Cheese's lead. Let's listen to Hacksaw Dugan.
Now, you people look out here and see right now Hacksaw Dugan stands out here. He looks a little rejected, a little dejected, a little disappointed. A little disappointed in a friend of mine. A man that was stood behind my back, shoulder to shoulder with me at times. A man that stood right here in this spot, on this very ground, looked me right in the eye, face to face, took my hand and said, Hacksaw, I, Ted DiBiase, won't have nothing to do with Skandar Akbar. Well, you lied, Teddy. You lied to me. You took my hand, you took my friendship, and you lied. Yeah, we've been through some tough times. We've been in some rough jams together, and we pulled out of it. But just when you say you're going to shoot straight with Hacksaw and you pull something like this, go your way, DiBiase. Go your way, and I'll go mine. Let's our paths not cross. Remember the good times. But Skandar Akbar, people just don't realize how rotten you are. Since I've come to Mid-South, since I've come here, I've had nothing to do with you because I could see through your phony, baloney crap. I know what kind of man you are. I know about how you get your money, where you get your oil money, and the type of people you associate with. Let me tell you something. A lot of people might not agree with the way I look or the way I act. But I'm going to tell you something. Nobody in this country will deny me the right to act the way I want and to be what I want to be. You come around here, Akbar, and I'm a proud man, and I'm proud to be an American. Let me tell you something. You got those ties with them oil people, and that man from Iran, that sheik, there's something very personal in my history of my family that's going back a long way, Akbar, and I'm going to take it out on you once and for all.
Boy, I don't think Skandar Akbar or anybody else takes Hacksaw Jim Dugan's words lightly. Anybody he's threatened, he has gone after. But now let's go to the match that set a precedent never before done in the history of wrestling, and an unadvertised steel cage match. It was a real well-kept secret, certainly surprised Akbar and Mr. Olympia. Let's watch that match between JYD, Mr. Olympia, for the North American title that was held up and the $10,000 prize.
The steel cage is erected unbeknownst to Skandar Akbar and Mr. Olympia. They did not realize this is the first time ever in history there's been an unadvertised steel cage match. Of course, all the fans that went to the Superdome got that bonus, not realizing what they were going to get. They knew they were going to get a match between JYD and Mr. Olympia. There you see the referee with the North American title belt that has been held up. But they didn't realize there was going to be a steel cage match, nor did Skandar Akbar or Mr. Olympia. This was a well-concealed secret. You can see Olympia very upset. Skandar Akbar tremendously upset. There's Mr. Olympia, a tremendous athlete. You know that he's had a long, grueling bout to defend the Mid-South Tag Team titles. Now he has to come up against the most powerful, the most dynamic, the most successful athlete ever in professional wrestling at this point. JYD, the big thumper. And JYD is boiling. He's not waiting. They locked that gate and it started because it's one fall, no disqualification for the North American title. And the $10,000, more than the dollars, more than the title, I think it's the pride that this man, Mr. Olympia, his former Mid-South tag partner, a man who JYD had watched after, taken care of, and helped to attain stardom, who had made the most money he'd ever made thus far in his career, had double-crossed him and turned against him, all for greed and the lies and conniving of Skandar Akbar. And you can see he's holding him up and just pounding him. This turned into not a lot of skill, not a lot of science, just animal, just total animalism, and I guess you got to get down to say street fight, alley brawling type. Just say, hey, I'm going to whip you. I'm going to prove to everybody who's more man. Now, again, the steel cage Mid-South thought would stop all interference, but we're going to see later a interruption in this film clip. Skandar Akbar, even caught totally unaware, had still gone back and got the Black Ninja to attempt to spew the green fleam through the opening in the cage and blind JYD. And Akbar had run over to where our cameraman was shooting, right here. You see, that's the ninja leaving. Akbar had just run over and pulled the power cord to stop the filming so that we could not have it on record as to what had actually happened, where we did not get the actual act of the ninja. All we saw was him retreating like a thief in the night. And Junkyard Dog is blinded. The fans are so upset. Olympia's on him, trying to finish him off to take the title. There's a fan that takes and throws beer that possibly diluted the green fleam and kept damage and kept Dog where he could have enough senses to again climb. Here's when you see a great athlete pulling out all stops just to try to break this sleeper. Olympia does have the sleeper, and Dog is going unconscious, but Olympia's shoulders are down. Olympia forgot to protect his shoulders, although it's a very controversial rule situation, because he was instigating the submission hold and was in control, but still his shoulders were down and Rick Ferrara counted it down. Olympia at this point thinks he has won, that he has won because the Dog was in the sleeper. But Rick Ferrara is very crystal clear on it. He has awarded the win to the Junkyard Dog. The Junkyard Dog has won the belt, the North American title belt, and the $10,000 there. They're unlocking the cage. He's going to give the belt to the Junkyard Dog. Junkyard Dog has regained some measure of pride, but I promise you, this is not ended, because the Dog hasn't gotten his revenge in total, and Mr. Olympia is still a threat under the guise of Skandar Akbar and with Ted DiBiase.
Certainly, Boyd, we would be remiss in not giving Skandar Akbar and Mr. Olympia their chance to voice their opinion of what happened in the Superdome. But whatever they voice, it can't change the record that the Junkyard Dog is now the North American champion. But let's listen to Skandar Akbar and Mr. Olympia now.
Going back to March 21st in New Orleans, the North American title tournament night, we were denied the title after you put the man unconscious. They could have counted to 200 and the Dog would have never woken. And now they try to put more swerves Mid-South. They stop payment on the check, the board meeting, the so-called board meeting of snakes. Then they deny everything. And in the Superdome, the most illustrious wrestling match of its type in the whole world, we go out with Ted DiBiase and we successfully defend the newly won Mid-South coveted tag team titles. Then, double duty, the man goes and pays his dues again. It's double duty time. He's facing Dog in a special challenge. And we get to the ring, and I have never in my, all of my career, and I go back a long time, ever see a cage put around a match, never advertised, in New Orleans, in the Superdome of all things.
And I put him to sleep. I had it. I put him to sleep.
Exactly.
And they count my shoulders out, and I don't get the belt. I don't get the money. I don't get nothing.
But I will tell you this, Mid-South. You listen, Smith, and you, Lay, and everybody connected and associated with Mid-South. My attorneys are working on this day and night. This time, you won't get away with it. We're ready for all contingents. We're ready for everybody. Mr. Olympia's got a vendetta.
I'm going to settle it, too.
There, you viewed it, and you listened to what they had to say. But still, the Junkyard Dog is the new North American heavyweight champion, but you and I know and we realize deep down inside that General Skander Akbar will not rest on his laurels, and you can bet your bottom dollar that Mr. Olympia and Ted DiBiase will be after that North American heavyweight title. We have more interesting things to come right after this important message.
Well, King Kong Bundy at 6'5", 420 is a big, impressive man, and he called a meeting to make a statement about some new tactic he had to reveal to us here on Mid-South today in the ring. We pre-taped that interview. After listening to that interview, we'll go direct to the ring for King Kong Bundy's match and see just exactly what this new tactic is. I'm sure with his size and strength, whatever it is, it will be devastating, as he is of Devastation Incorporated. Let's listen to that now.
You know, when I talk about Devastation Incorporated, I want you people to know what Devastation Incorporated is. I have trainers, I have financial advisors, I have people that take care of every facet of my business. And one of my advisors has come up with something brand new, something from the East. Something from the East, something people down the South have never heard of, could never possibly think of. It's called the Atlantic City Avalanche. And I'm gonna unveil the Avalanche tonight, and when you see it, ain't nobody gonna believe it. It's 420 pounds crushing somebody, and when these promoters see it, they're going to realize you can't hold back King Kong Bundy anymore. I'm going to have the opponents I want. Junkyard Dog, Mr. Wrestling 2, Tiger Conway, Hacksaw Reed, Dusty Rhodes, and Andre the Giant. That's right, Andre the Giant. You're going to feel the Atlantic City Avalanche too. Nobody's safe from it. You're going to see it, but ain't nobody going to believe it.
This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner, at 420 pounds from Atlantic City, New Jersey, King Kong Bundy. And in the blue corner, at 290 pounds from Knoxville, Tennessee, Don Clark.
Don Clark being introduced from Tennessee, 290 pounds, but his opponent, a bigger man than he, from Atlantic City, New Jersey, King Kong Bundy, as Rick Ferrara calls for the bell. Here's Bill.
Well, I think this is the biggest man Bundy has faced here on Mid-South Wrestling, and a man 290 pounds, but Bundy is 420. However, it should make it more interesting. Bundy just seems to have awesome power, tremendous strength reserve. You heard him announce that he was going to reveal the Atlantic City Avalanche here. Of course, this is the man that when he pins somebody, it goes to a five count, not a three count. So we're all eyes here. Don Clark ducked under that elbow. May have saved him from being decapitated. But Bundy really pouring the wood to him there. Wow, you could hear these chops going off clear over here at our booth, Boyd Pierce.
And we got to realize, Bill, this is 290 pounds.
Bundy's a massive man. You know, the mass is not what gets you, it's the movement. If the guy is big and can move, it makes him awesome. It's so hard to stop a huge man's move. Once he gets the momentum and the weight going, it just takes you. Bundy's really punishing him. King Kong Bundy. Powerful man. Oh, he is really beating up this Don Clark. Turnbuckle. Oh, awesome power. It's just like getting run over by a freight train. Nothing stops it. There Bundy goes. He picks the man up. Wow, he dove 420 pounds.
That's the five count in this case, Bill.
King Kong Bundy, a five count. That was the Atlantic City Avalanche, I guess, Boyd. Looked a little bit to me like an Oklahoma Stampede.
I've seen it before under a different name. We'll be back with more action after this word.
This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner, at 250 pounds from the Far East, the Black Ninja, Kendo Nagasaki. And in the blue corner, at 226 pounds from Chattanooga, Tennessee, Ken Woodby.
Ken Woodby being introduced in the burgundy tights, and across the ring, his opponent, General Skandar Akbar, in the ring with the Oriental Star, Kendo Nagasaki, the Black Ninja. Bill Watts?
The Black Ninja against Ken Woodby, Boyd. And, of course, I'm still reflecting on the Atlantic City Avalanche by King Kong Bundy. And again, it seems to me like his original technique, the new technique, is a little bit like the Oklahoma Stampede, which Dr. Death Steve Williams uses, and certainly I used to use. We'll have to see what he develops off of it. Kendo Nagasaki, a vicious man, martial arts man, member of General Skandar Akbar's ever-growing army of dominance. Kendo Nagasaki really bearing down on this guy. Alpha Neely warning him to be sure to break, four count to break. These guys can use that four count, though, and drag it out. All they got to do is break clear, and they're right back on you. Skandar Akbar there. Kendo Nagasaki. He's pounding this man. Thrust kick. We've seen him do some severe damage with that thrust kick. He was the one that thrust kicked the dog in the March 21st tournament in downtown New Orleans, causing the dog to be unable to continue as Mr. Olympia supposedly had taken that title, which was later held up. The dog won April 16th in that tremendous Superdome. Kendo Nagasaki is really the crowd roaring. Here comes Hacksaw Jim Duggan. He brushed right by Akbar and dumped Nagasaki. Maybe he was, there's the true target, I think. Skandar Akbar, Dugan's after him. Dugan's got Nagasaki's foot hung in the rope, and Hacksaw Dugan is, he's tearing Akbar's clothes off. He's pounding. Skandar Akbar is listening to this crowd. Hacksaw Jim Dugan, a man of his word. He's torn Akbar's pants. Akbar's just almost disrobed out there, Boyd Pearson. If there gets much more clothing off of him, we'd have to break away.
The ninja's still entwined in those ropes.
Oh, I know it. Jim Dugan must have attacked the ninja so he'd get rid of him first so he'd have the time to Akbar. I think this has caught everybody by shock and surprise about Hacksaw Dugan. It's certainly a man that when he says he's going to attack, he'll attack. And look at the Hacksaw. I think he's served notice that he's going to be his own man.
And Bill, we'll leave the air, but we're coming right back. It'll be the new North American Heavyweight Champion, the Junkyard Dog, in action with his new music bringing him on, the Atomic Dog, right after this word.
This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner, at 240 pounds, from Atlanta, Georgia, Ron Cheatham. Coming into the ring now, the new North American Heavyweight Champion at 283 pounds, the Junkyard Dog.
And in the ring is the new North American Heavyweight Champion, the Junkyard Dog. You heard his music and you heard the accolades of the fans in the background against Ron Cheatham.
Well, Boyd, one thing I like about the Junkyard Dog, he's surpassed race, color, and creed. He represents the people. They all love him. And his new music, the Atomic Dog, the new North American title, he says he's a new dog, and I guarantee you, he's the most exciting athlete in professional sports today. He's got the largest, most faithful following. The man is just tremendous. And he's come up the hard way right out of hunger and hard times and fought and clawed and stomped his way up. And the Big Thumper, he's not ashamed of where he started. He's not ashamed of the people that helped get him there. He's with them all the way. He doesn't forget his beginnings, doesn't forget his roots. He goes out there and goes after him. And Ron Cheatham, you're right in the middle of a hot seat now. JYD, he doesn't waste any time. No, when they're out in that ring, they don't get paid by the hour. It all goes down to just beat the man, however long it takes. And Junkyard Dog doesn't let any grass grow. He goes right after him. Powerful man, bench presses in excess of 500 pounds. There's that clothesline, and he likely took Ron Cheatham's head off. Of course, Mr. Olympia, Ted DiBiase, King Kong Bundy, Kamala the Ugandan, a Black Ninja are just a few. We're going to feel the wrath of JYD.
The Big Thump, the new North American heavyweight champion, Junkyard Dog, in action with a victory. We have more action coming up after this word.
This event is for one fall or remaining television time. In the red corner, at 244 pounds, and seconded by Ted DiBiase, Mr. Olympia. In the blue corner at 250 pounds from Topeka, Kansas, Art Cruz.
Art Cruz, a popular star from Kansas, being introduced, and his opponent across the ring, Mr. Olympia. And as Reeser said, his second during this match is his team partner, Ted DiBiase.
Well, of course, his second is manager, Skandar Akbar. He got run over by a freight train called Hacksaw Dugan and practically disrobed out here. And Grizzly Smith says he's going to try to get Skandar Akbar out here for us to talk to. I kind of wonder that Ted DiBiase may not have a little tingling going down his spine because he's seen Hacksaw Dugan's reaction. See, DiBiase's out there to second Mr. Olympia in his street clothes, but he's also got his wrestling shoes on, meaning he's just not too sure of what Hacksaw Dugan. You know, when DiBiase came back, he said the Big Cheese was back and that he'd straighten Dugan out, that Dugan needed a little bit of discipline for overstepping himself for firing Matthew Bourne. But I think it's a little deeper. Dugan told me that he just doesn't like Skandar Akbar. He doesn't like where he's from. He doesn't like the method or the way they hijacked the United States in the oil crisis. And the Akbar's association with the Iron Sheik has something deep into family situation with Hacksaw Dugan. And he'd asked DiBiase once before if he was going to have anything to do with Skandar Akbar. And Teddy kind of looked, and I remember, at Dugan's eyes and denied it. But I always suspected DiBiase was plotting something with Akbar, and it's all come out in the open, as has Mr. Olympia. He's kind of come out of the closet, so to speak, too. And the general thought they were really sitting in control, but Hacksaw Dugan is a man of few words. He's a direct man. If he says, I'm going to come whip you, brother, you better get ready to roll up your sleeves and fight. He's coming after you. He's not going to mince words. He doesn't care if he comes with a gang by himself or what it is. He's going to come fight you. I've always respected Hacksaw Dugan, because there was nothing that he didn't say he wasn't going to do. He just went right after you. Here's a man, Mr. Olympia.
Not only that, Bill, but we saw Hacksaw Dugan sacrifice his body time after time, you know, so.
He doesn't care. He doesn't care. Talk about somebody who doesn't care what happens to their body. Chavo Guerrero will be here next week on Mid-South Wrestling. Also, Grizzly Smith has set a great main event on Mid-South Wrestling for you fans at home. Right here on TV next week, Mr. Wrestling 2 will face King Kong Bundy. We'll really see what the big King Kong Bundy's made of. Mr. Olympia, he's a man that, if you're sitting in his shoes, he figures that he has really got the shaft, because he won the North American title, had the check stopped, the title held up, and then walked into the cage match that wasn't advertised. The only time in the history of wrestling that's ever happened. I know promoters everywhere, when they have a chance to get somebody in a steel cage match, they raise the prices, they advertise the heck out of it. Mid-South snuck the cage into the Superdome, didn't tell anybody, then during the intermission put it up where when Mr. Olympia and Akbar came to the ring, they saw the cage and they were livid. And it's like the deck was stacked, but certainly they stacked the deck with others before, and I think they were getting paid back in kind, and I think Mid-South Wrestling really deserves a tremendous accolade for everybody in wrestling, the wrestlers themselves, as well as the fans. And of course, those fans that went to the Superdome, they got a bonus, because only that happened there, and it'll probably never happen again. It's a once-in-a-lifetime situation. Art Cruz out there going after Mr. Olympia. Olympia is a tremendous athlete. I'll tell you, it's not over with him in the Junkyard Dog. You can be sure of that. And it's not over with him in wrestling, too, or he and Tiger Conway. And one thing you got to say, Olympia's been a champion. He's had a taste of that big money right here in Mid-South. When he became the dog partner, that's when he came out of obscurity into the big time. And he owes a lot to the Junkyard Dog, and now he's, so to speak, trying to surpass the dog and take over. But you can see, he can't look back now. He's totally committed. DiBiase out there seconding. This is one fall or television time remaining. Art Cruz fighting back. Art Cruz is going after. This young man, Art Cruz, got a lot of heart. He's going to be a real comer on Mid-South. Olympia a little bit more experience. High knee. Crowd was starting to really get with Art Cruz. But Olympia just cut him off. There he's going for the pile driver. Olympia pile drives him. This is a lot more vicious, determined man than we'd ever seen in the past. Sleeper.
Now Fernini checking out the sleeper, calls for the bell, and Mr. Olympia gains the victory.
Camera over here, we've got General Scanlon.
This is the American way, Duggan. The proud Arab people. We don't do any dastardly attacks from behind. A man of my pride and distinction, humiliation. Oh, if only Kamala were here next week. But he's got an important commitment in Dallas, Texas. But wait just a minute, DiBiase, come here. Come here. You saw what happened out there, DiBiase. I want this man eliminated. Boy, I'm going to eliminate you, Duggan. Nobody humiliates a general like that. I'm pulling out all stops, DiBiase. All stops. Money is no object. I want Duggan eliminated.
Minute,
you understand?
Minute, General. Wait a minute. Everybody knows that Duggan and I we've split sheets. We've gone our separate ways. Look, the man doesn't want to be a member of the Rat Pack anymore. That's his business. That's his problem, because now he's out there on his own. But he's a former member of the Rat Pack, and as long as he doesn't interfere in my matches or in the Mid-South Tag Team titles, then I will not fight the man. I'm not afraid of him, but he's a former Rat Pack member.
All right, I'll get the ninja. All right, I'll eliminate you, boy. And you'll think it's Christmas in May because we'll spray you so green. You'll never show up again. Nobody does that to the general and walks around and talk about it.
Boy, Derry, you've heard a challenge, and Akbar is certainly upset. And, interesting thing with DiBiase. He made it crystal clear he wasn't afraid of Jim Duggan, but he didn't want any part of him.
Not volunteering.
No, that's sure true. I don't know of anybody in their right mind that want to volunteer, because you know one thing with Jim Duggan, you're going to be in a fight. I'll guarantee you that, but we'll see next week. Apparently, Akbar has said he's going to get the ninja if he gets with Grizzly Smith. That's another terrific match we'll have here on Mid-South next week to go along with Chavo Guerrero. Also, that great main event, Wrestling 2 against King Kong Bundy. So the fans got to be sure to tune in next week.
And talking about fans, we do want to take this opportunity. Sometimes we don't have time to tell you, but this week we have a few seconds left. We want to share that with you. We appreciate so much. Every week, you come letting us come into your homes. We appreciate so much you attending the matches when they're in your area. Thank you so much for the ratings you give us that we've not given you, but top-ranked matches and top-flight fans. So for Cowboy Bill Watts, I'm Boyd Pearson. Goodbye, everybody, until next week on Mid-South Wrestling Television Network. We'll be right back. Hi, everybody, and welcome to this week's edition of Mid-South Wrestling Television. I'm your host, Boyd Pierce. We have a lot of exciting action. You'll see a special challenge match, the Black Ninja, Kendo Nagasaki, in the ring against Hacksaw Jim Duggan. Also, a wild battle between Mr. Wrestling 2 and Big Powerhouse King Kong Bundy. Tag team action sees Hacksaw Butch Reed join forces with Tiger Conway Jr. It all spells excitement, and the man to tell you about it, Cowboy Bill Watts.
Well, that's right. Thank you, Boyd. And, you know, just recently in Houston, Texas, Chavo Guerrero, a tremendous athlete, was set up by the Rat Pack, by Ted DiBiase and Mr. Olympia. Gran Marcus, a superstar from Mexico that was scheduled in Houston to wrestle Chavo Guerrero, did not show up. And Olympia and DiBiase challenged him. The people picked DiBiase. And in the ensuing situation, DiBiase and Mr. Olympia both really did a number on Chavo Guerrero. It came about later that El Gran Marcus was never booked there, that DiBiase had somebody with a Mexican accent call promoter Paul Bosch and get El Gran Marcus on the card. So DiBiase said, we got even with you for showing up the Rat Pack on TV. But we do have a tape of Chavo Guerrero in a match right before his injury in the Superdome. We'll see later. But first of all, last week was excitement galore here. I'm telling you, anytime you tune into Mid-South Wrestling, you just got to hold on your seat. You never know what's going to happen. But Hacksaw Jim Duggan made a statement about DiBiase and Skandar Akbar last week and then lived up to it. Let's again listen to Hacksaw Jim Duggan's statement.
You know, you people look out here and see right now Hacksaw Duggan stands out here. He looks a little rejected, a little dejected, a little disappointed. A little disappointed in a friend of mine, a man that was stood behind my back, shoulder to shoulder with me at times, a man that stood right here in this spot, on this very ground, looked me right in the eye, face to face, took my hand and said, Hacksaw, I, Ted DiBiase, won't have nothing to do with Skandar Akbar. Well, you lied, Teddy. You lied to me. You took my hand, you took my friendship, and you lied. Yeah, we've been through some tough times. We've been in some rough jams together, and we've pulled out of it. But just when you say you're going to shoot straight with Hacksaw and you pull something like this, go your way, DiBiase. Go your way, and I'll go mine. Let's our paths not cross. Remember the good times. But Skandar Akbar, people just don't realize how rotten you are. Since I've come to Mid-South, since I've come here, I've had nothing to do with you because I could see through your phony, baloney crap. I know what kind of man you are. I know about how you get your money, where you get your oil money, and the type of people you associate with. Let me tell you something. A lot of people might not agree with the way I look or the way I act. But I'm going to tell you something. Nobody in this country will deny me the right to act the way I want and to be what I want to be. You come around here, Akbar, and I'm a proud man, and I'm proud to be an American. Let me tell you something. You got those ties with them oil people and that man from Iran, that sheikh. There's something very personal in my history of my family that's going back a long way, Akbar, and I'm going to take it out on you once and for all.
Jim Duggan is direct and to the point. He's been beat before, but he's always marked the person who's gotten to him and says, I'll get even. And he wasn't too fancy about the way he did it. Of course, we all remember him with the gorilla incident where he cost Junkyard Dog to have to leave for 90 days, and that's when Stagger Lee came on the scene. And he no sooner had made the threat to Skandar Akbar than he took the first opportunity to start getting even as he tore Skandar Akbar's clothes completely off of him just about. We almost went X-rated at that point, Boyd Pierce. Let's watch that happened here last week on Mid-South. Kendo Nagasaki is really a crowd roaring. Here comes Hacksaw Jim Duggan. He brushed right by Akbar and dumped Nagasaki. Maybe he was, there's the true target, I think. Skandar Akbar, Duggan's after him. Duggan's got Nagasaki's foot hung in the rope, and Hacksaw Duggan is, he's tearing Akbar's clothes off. He's pounding. Skandar Akbar is listening to this crowd. Hacksaw Jim Duggan, a man of his word. He's torn Akbar's pants. Akbar's just almost disrobed out there, Boyd Pierce. If there gets much more clothing off of him, we'd have to break away.
The ninja's still entwined in those ropes.
Well, I know it.
Jim Duggan must have attacked the ninja so he'd get rid of him first so he'd have the time to act. I think this has caught everybody by shock and surprise about Hacksaw Duggan. It's certainly a man that when he says he's going to attack, he'll attack. And look at the Hacksaw. I think he's served notice that he's going to be his own man.
Skandar Akbar made a challenge to Hacksaw Jim Duggan. The amazing thing about it was he asked DiBiase to do his dirty work because Kamala, his number one man, was tied up in Dallas, Texas this week. You know, Akbar's like a conglomerate. Maybe he's getting a little too scattered out trying to subdue too many areas. And DiBiase quickly said, I'm not afraid of Duggan, but I'm going to let it go. It's between you and him. Akbar said the ninja will do it. He issued a challenge. Let's listen to Akbar's challenge.
Camera over here. We've got General
Skandar. This is the American way, Duggan. The proud Arab people. We don't do any dastardly attacks from behind. A man of my pride and distinction, humiliation. Oh, if only Kamala were here next week. But he's got an important commitment in Dallas, Texas. But wait just a minute, DiBiase, come here. Come here. You saw what happened out there, DiBiase. I want this man eliminated. Boy, I'm going to eliminate you, Duggan. Nobody humiliates a general like that. I'm pulling out all stops, DiBiase. All stops. Money is no object. I want Duggan eliminated.
Minute,
you understand?
Minute, General. Wait a minute. Wait a minute. And everybody knows that Duggan and I have, we've split sheets. We've gone our separate ways. Look, the man doesn't want to be a member of the Rat Pack anymore. That's his business. That's his problem. Because now he's out there on his own. But he's a former member of the Rat Pack, and as long as he doesn't interfere in my matches or in the Mid-South Tag Team titles, then I will not fight the man. I'm not afraid of him, but he's a former Rat Pack member, and I will.
All right, all right, I'll get the ninja. All right, I'll eliminate you, boy. And you'll think it's Christmas in May because we'll spray you so green. You'll never show up again. Nobody does that to the general and walks around and talk about it.
Now you heard General Skandar Akbar and his challenge, and the opportunist matchmaker Grizzly Smith, not one to pass up a great match, so he signed that match and made it a challenge bout, and we'll be able to see that. Hacksaw Jim Duggan versus Kendo Nagasaki, the Black Ninja, and it'll be coming up right after this message.
This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. One fall, 10-minute time limit. Coming into the ring right now, under the management of General Skandar Akbar, at 250 pounds from the Far East, the Black Ninja, Kendo Nagasaki. And in the blue corner, at 270 pounds from New York City, Hacksaw Duggan.
Hacksaw Duggan is in the ring. Bill Watts, Nagasaki is there, but Akbar didn't make it.
He's not waiting for any bell. He's attacking Kendo Nagasaki. You can hear the crowd holler, Duggan, 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 and Duggan is going after him. He's not going to let the ninja even get out of his gear. He's getting right after him. That's DiBiase. DiBiase, he's loading up that glove. Ted DiBiase. And he really KO'd Hacksaw Duggan. DiBiase with that glove. And he's got Duggan down, and Dugan's lights are out. The ninja, both of them, and Akbar. Ted DiBiase had said he wasn't going to have anything to do, that it was between Akbar and Duggan. But DiBiase came in from behind and double-crossed his former Rat Pack partner. Ted DiBiase has torn it now, Boyd Pierce.
And Bill, things try to slow down here, we'll be back right after this important message.
Well, Boyd Pierce, while we get everything back to order here, that's torn it. DiBiase's torn it. He may as well have been the one out there because he's certainly with Akbar 100% against Hacksaw Jim Duggan, and I guarantee you sparks are going to fly. And as we talked earlier about Chavo Guerrero, we hope that he gets better. He really sustained a beating at the hands of DiBiase and Mr. Olympia in Houston, Texas. We hope next week to have that film clip. But first, let's watch Chavo Guerrero on the 16th of April in the Superdome as he showed just what makes him a great superstar, that kind of heart and courage as he wrestled Wild Bill Irwin. Let's watch that bout now.
Don't go for the bell.
There we see the face of Wild Bill Irwin. Chavo Guerrero with the arm bar, the legs extended, forcing Irwin over. He was reaching for the ropes to hang on. Usher going for the count. Irwin rolls his shoulders up. This is not a pinning combination. It's more of a submissive situation where it puts a lot of pressure on the elbow through the arm block. Chavo Guerrero, a man highly skilled
in all facets of wrestling. Switches in right there to a short arm scissor. I bet people haven't seen that since the day of Danny Hodge, when he was in his prime some 10 years ago. More than that, more like 15 years ago. Danny was great at that hold, a short arm scissor. Excruciating hold. Now you're all also going to see what a great, powerful young athlete Wild Bill Irwin is, as he flat picks Chavo Guerrero up in these edited highlights of that match in the Louisiana Superdome on April 16th. Look at Bill Irwin from that short arm, very little leverage. He just powers Chavo up, and the balance is so fine that Chavo, by swinging his arm, can get himself moving forward again, and Irwin can't hold him. Usher looking on. Chavo Guerrero, one of the most powerful young men of his size, tremendously strong, tremendous heart, great athlete. He attacks his opponent with reckless abandon. Of course, right here, Wild Bill Irwin, a youngster who we saw start out his professional career, who has really become a young star in his own right. There he goes with a Greco-Roman move. Goes for the fall. Chavo powers out. Chavo Guerrero, a man who the Rat Pack set up in Houston, Texas. Ted DiBiase and his new man of his alliance, Mr. Olympia. Irwin goes for broke. This is when you're going for broke. This is in a big place like the Superdome. Lots of money on the line. A lot of people there, over 20,000 people watching these bouts. You go for broke on it. This is the one you want to show off. The magazines from New York, everybody covering the event. Promoter Paul Bosch from Houston there. Everybody looking in. Bill Irwin took a chance and he missed. Chavo Guerrero fighting back. Great heart, great athlete, Chavo Guerrero. We hope that he gets well soon from that incident that happened with DiBiase and Mr. Olympia in Houston, Texas. We hope to have a film clip of that here next week on Mid-South Wrestling. Talking about going for broke and not caring about your own personal safety. Look at Chavo Guerrero. The only man I've ever seen that just in total abandon will dive right out of the ring on his opponent and just level him like a cross-body block at the head level, right down to that concrete floor. And we see Wild Bill Irwin coming up. Chavo had crawled around the ring. You'll see him coming on camera to the right here. He's hurt too, but he was having to give himself some breathing space. He had to, at times, this is what makes Chavo so great, is he'll do something crazy or wild in order to give himself time to regain himself against his bigger opponents. Wild Bill Irwin coming on him. He's going for a win in the Superdome. Misses that reverse elbow, but you see a great athlete. He doesn't think about what he missed. He goes for his next move, that wild flying high kick, and he really catches Chavo. Going for an atomic drop. But Chavo, with that tremendous agility over the top, front to back suplex. Look at the high arch. You can see there's no doubt as to whose shoulders are pinned there. Chavo Guerrero wins the match.
Well, I think Chavo's action speaks louder than words, Boyd.
Bill, that's right, and that was a great match from the Dome on April the 16th. King Kong Bundy, who says he's brought a new hope to Mid-South Wrestling in the Atlantic City Avalanche, but we know that's not so, because I've seen my sidekick, Cowboy Bill Watts. He's the master of the Oklahoma Stampeder, so it's nothing new to us regardless of what he says. We'll listen to him and then see him in action after this word.
In the background, you hear the crowd hollering 2-2-2 as he goes to the ring. But first, let's hear King Kong Bundy's remarks about the living legend, Mr. Wrestling 2, that he made just prior to this taping session. King Kong Bundy.
When I came to Mid-South Wrestling, I told these promoters I came here to wrestle top-flight competition. Well, finally, I've got what I wanted, because after last week, when I showed the Atlantic City Avalanche, these promoters know they can no longer deny King Kong Bundy. And now I've got Mr. Wrestling 2, the living legend of professional wrestling. Well, let me tell you something, too. You've never wrestled anything. You've never been in the ring with anything like King Kong Bundy. And as for your big knee, look at this, too. I've got a 26-inch neck. And that can absorb plenty of shock and take plenty of punishment, and no knee is going to bother me. You're going down, too. You're going down for the five count. The Avalanche is going to put you down. I'll put you down for five. I'll put you down for 10. I may put you down long enough for them to plant daisies. King Kong Bundy, the dominant force in professional wrestling.
This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner, at 420 pounds from Atlantic City.
And Wrestling 2 gets a 5 count by King Kong Bundy. I think Wrestling 2 could probably be counted to 10 or 15 right now because we saw Mr. Olympia as Bundy sits out there and takes the credit. Mr. Olympia, the man who's promised to end the career of Wrestling 2, and you see the crowd, and they're very unhappy.
Bill, we'll have more action following this important message from Mid-South Wrestling.
This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 268 pounds from Omaha, Nebraska, Ted DiBiase. And in the blue corner at 222 pounds from Knoxville, Tennessee, Tim Horner.
Tim Horner now taking off his maroon jacket against Ted DiBiase. And Bill Watts, if you'll notice, Skandar Akbar is in the ring with Ted. But in there, a match between Hacksaw Jim Duggan and the Black Ninja, General Skandar Akbar was at the ring, but he was trailing far behind and did not come into the ring.
Yes, he was very apprehensive. Crowd is shouting, Dugan, Dugan, Dugan. DiBiase was smiling. Akbar was smirking as they went in the ring. DiBiase upset about the crowd. DiBiase has proven what a treacherous individual he is. Without a doubt, Junkyard Dog, of course, is long known what a treacherous person. There's a man, the Junkyard Dog was the best man at Ted's wedding, and Ted turned on him. And now Ted has turned on Hacksaw Dugan after Dugan has sacrificed himself many times to save Ted DiBiase. And then DiBiase said, Dugan, let's just go our own way. And the only way of DiBiase's way is when he jumps you from behind and gets a chance to load that glove. And now Ted DiBiase is after Tim Horner. And of course, he was really gloating. Wrestling 2 during the commercial break had to be practically carried from the ring. His eyes were glassy, his knees were wobbling. Mr. Olympia, the man who was mentally trying to torture Wrestling 2 for so long, and Wrestling 2 almost upset Mr. Olympia's plan to double cross Junkyard Dog. The whole crowd is hollering for Dugan, Dugan, Dugan. They are pointing at Akbar and hollering, Dugan, Dugan, Dugan. And DiBiase is upset. Tim Horner, a great young athlete, I'll guarantee you. Tim Horner, he goes right after him. I've really been impressed with his ability, his conditioning, and his heart. You got a former North American champion there, Ted DiBiase, now one half of the Mid-South Tag Team Championship with Mr. Olympia. So you've got one of the top wrestlers in the nation today. Hacksaw Jim Dugan, like I say, felt the conniving deviousness of DiBiase, a man who just a week ago told Akbar that he wouldn't have anything to do with the problems between Akbar and Dugan. Now, in a week's time, do you think Akbar sweetened the pot that much? Or was DiBiase just trying to get Dugan to relax his guard and DiBiase not being able to stand the fact that Dugan had really captured the crowd's fancy as the head rat packer? And DiBiase said he was the big cheese and he called all the shots, and Dugan had overstepped himself firing that horn. Body tackle. Tim Horner just quicker than lightning. And he's got the former North American champion and the co-holder of the Mid-South tag title. He had him on the go. DiBiase, though, was larger in size and more experience, trying to retaliate. He's taking it to Horner. Of course, it all broke down when DiBiase's greed formed an alliance with Skandar Akbar and Mr. Olympia. Now DiBiase giving it back to the crowd. The crowd, though, they're cheering for Hacksaw Dugan, a man who said he's proud to be an American. Said, I may be rough, I may be tough, I do my own alley fighting. Whoa, Tim Horner came, Horner came charging in. DiBiase got that knee right up into the sternum area of Horner. And DiBiase really carrying it. Now the crowd hollering, JYD, JYD, JYD. They just hate DiBiase and want somebody to shut him up. DiBiase, an elbow off the second rope. As long as you jump with your feet off the second rope, it's legal.
leaps off the top rope, it is an automatic disqualification. And Tim Horner is finding out why Ted DiBiase, hate him or not, is a tough man to be in the ring against. Next week here on TV, we hope to have Kerry and David Von Erich versus the Fabulous Freebirds. That should be a great bout for those of you at home. Be sure to tune in Mid-South as you are faithful and loyal to do each and every week. Horner firing back. He got a shot in over the ribs of DiBiase, but DiBiase knows to fight himself out of trouble and not get that momentum going against him. Horner forearm into DiBiase's chops there. There you see the general. The general's got a very formidable stable right now. Olympia, DiBiase, Kamala, and the Black Ninja. What a formidable crew. Oh, Tim Horner. He was going for broke. You got to admire him. The only way to go against a man like DiBiase is all out and hope to beat him. DiBiase sets, takes his time when he's got his man in trouble. King Kong Bundy registered a win over the legendary Mr. Wrestling 2. That's how it went down the record book. And 2 was counted down for a 5 count. I think we all saw when Olympia drop-kicked him, there was something black covering that right red boot of Mr. Olympia, and 2's lights were out. The crowd just wanting somebody to measure DiBiase. Power slam! DiBiase's caught him with a power slam. That's it. No, DiBiase pulled him up. DiBiase wants to punish him. DiBiase's so cocky, he's wanting to punish him. DiBiase wanting Horner to pay. He had him beat. He had him beat on that power slam, and he knew it, but he picked him up. He's wanting to punish him some more. He's really cocky. DiBiase, cocky and mean and ornery. And there he's on top of Tim Horner. He's on top, and he's really taking it to Tim Horner. Tim Horner was beat from that power slam. Tim, a gallant young battler out there, just outgunned a little bit. And DiBiase really taking advantage of it. Crowd cheering. Hacksaw Dugan coming behind on DiBiase. Oh, he hit him right in the gut with a 2x4. He broke that 2x4. He broke a 2x4 over DiBiase. Hacksaw Dugan walking tall. He's walking tall. And Akbar's running out of there. Akbar's running out of there. Listen to this crowd, boy.
I don't blame him a bit for running, Bill. Unloading it all.
Come on.
You've knocked. He's out.
You better believe he's out. And you, if anybody, Bill Watts, should understand, sometimes a man needs to walk tall. A man needs to walk tall. And Hacksaw Dugan is that man. DiBiase, part of Akbar, he lied to me. Man to man, a friend. Akbar, I'm a proud American, Bill Watts. I'm a proud man of a proud family. A lot of people may not agree with the way I live or my lifestyle, but I can do it in America, and God bless America, and I'll fight for what's right. And what's right is the way I live and the way I want to live. Not DiBiase, not that backstabbing Akbar.
Well, he just said it, Boyd Pierce. Hacksaw Dugan said he was going to walk tall. And listen to the crowd, they love it, and Akbar's backing off.
He rolled it all into one, Bill, and said it very nicely, and we'll be back with tag team action after this word from Mid-South Wrestling.
It's tag team action now for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner, at 240 pounds, from Knoxville, Tennessee, Don Cheatham. And his partner at 290 pounds, from Atlanta, Georgia, Don Clark. In the blue corner, at 252 pounds, from Kansas City, Missouri, Hacksaw Butch Reed. And his partner at 238 pounds from Houston, Texas, Tiger Conway Jr.
Tag team action, Ron Cheatham and Don Clark versus the popular duo of Hacksaw Butch Reed and Tiger Conway Jr. Alfred Neely calls for the bell. Here's Bill.
Well, boy, Boy, they'd like to never got that crowd settled down with the way they were taken to the action by Hacksaw Dugan. I know when I was talking to him there or listening to him, chill bumps broke out on me when he talked about walking tall, and he's right. I do understand that some years ago when I was still active in Atlanta, Georgia, one Abdullah the Butcher and Ole Anderson and them, they just kind of overloaded everybody there. And I recall that I had to walk tall, and I got all their attention. I did some serious whipping of some people right off cable on national TV, right off the satellite, and I guess that Hacksaw Dugan must have viewed it and remembered it. And it certainly seemed that I'll admit that sometimes you just get so full of it that there's only one way to do it, and that's to handle it any way you can. When you're outnumbered, you know, Dugan's kind of all by himself right now against the most formidable crew ever with Akbar, Olympia, Kamala, and the Black Ninja. And Dugan just said, hey, you know, I got to go do any way I can. You're seeing two fine athletes out there right now, Tiger Conway Jr. and Hacksaw Butch Reed. And did you see the moves Butch Reed just made prior to Tiger coming in, where he was around that ring like a lightweight with all his size and power? And Conway, great athletes, both of these men. I don't know. These things are so happening. This is such action-packed action every week here on Mid-South. I enjoy so much getting to be the commentator. It's just like getting to live vicariously and enjoying these great athletes. And it's been a real pleasure. And I just don't know what to say or what to do. I don't know how matchmaker Grizzly Smith is going to make the matches, because there's so many things happening. It's just an ongoing thing. And I could just see Dugan, and you know he's going to go after DiBiase. It's not over. And you know Akbar's going to go after Dugan. And Jerry Usher almost got run over. Get out of the way. Now, excuse me, not Jerry Usher, Alfred Neely. Action gets so fast in these tag matches. These guys are so big, quick, and powerful. Just fantastic. Hacksaw Dugan. He says, I believe in America. I love America, and I can live, look, dress, walk, talk any way I want to. My lifestyle's my own, and I'm going to protect that freedom. And I think no matter what, that kind of a Damon Runyon's bandit type guy, but you got to respect him. He's tough. He's had his weapons. I remember one match, Boyd Pierce, when he split his head for 37 stitches against the ring post against Chavo Guerrero. And everybody thought he was finished, but he went right on back out and wrestled another match and beat up somebody else just with 37 stitches before he went to the doctor and got stitched up. And I remember Tony Atlas, as tough a man that ever came down a pike, made a complete fool out of him here one day, and Hacksaw picked his spot and he got to Tony Atlas. If he's going after you, you got to wonder. You better have your head on a swivel. You better be able to look 360 degrees. Tiger Conway, look at that drop kick. Clear up on Don Clark's face right there. Conway got such tremendous power. Both these men do. Oh, and Conway picked that 290-pounder up and just slung him down like a sack of grain. And there he's going again. This is what I'm talking about, the power and coordination of these athletes. Next week here on Mid-South, we got Kerry and David Von Erich against the Freebirds. It'll be a great bout. I just don't know what other matches Grizzly Smith, the matchmaker, is going to have. We got Ken Woodby and Tony Zane coming up, two young rookies. Hope you'll stay tuned and watch these youngsters. And this is the way they get a chance. I think this is commendable to Grizzly Smith, too, to give some kids that generally are out there against guys a lot more talented, a lot more experienced, give them a chance to show what they can do on television. And we've seen a lot of great ones. You can remember when DiBiase was Rookie of the Year here. And you can, Tiger Conway's playing games out there with Don Clark, showing that he's just not quite mobile enough. Oh, Cheatham came in, and Conway got out of the way, and Cheatham kicked his own man, and now you got Reed and Conway out there together. Oh, top kicks. Word from the dressing room that Wrestling 2 is getting it back together. A little bit shaky on his feet. A little bit upset, to say the least. A lot of upset. Oh, he backdropped that monster. Oh, Reed come off that flying body tackle. And that Cheatham don't want no more.
All that on a 290-pound opponent. The victors, Tiger Conway Jr. and Hacksaw Butch Reed. We'll have more action coming up after this message.
This event is for one fall or remaining television time. In the red corner, at 260 pounds from Rome, Georgia, Tony Zane. And in the blue corner, at 226 pounds from Chattanooga, Tennessee, Ken Woodby.
Two Southerners from Georgia and Tennessee, Tony Zane versus Ken Woodby. Zane is the larger of the two. Rick Pereira calls for the bell, and the two young rookies are on their way, each trying to grind out a victory here and move them up on top spots in later matches.
Oh boy, these are the kind of matches that I'm in favor of, too. Just like the main events, you got to give these guys a chance at an equal competition. Here's two relative newcomers to Mid-South out there trying to prove what they can do, and I think it's great. There's been an action pack, a lot of things happening. During the commercial break, the crowd was going, do again. So lots of things happening here. I also want to say thank you to the wrestling fans in the February rating books in Shreveport, right here where we produce Mid-South Wrestling. Mid-South took a 48 share of the market, and that is just tremendous. And again, our contract with Channel 3, with Mr. Newton Ray and Edwin Ray, his son, truly fine people, great gentlemen. It's been renewed for another 2 years, and I think this is indicative of them realizing just exactly how important Mid-South Wrestling is to their market, and it's happening in every market that Mid-South's in. And comparatively speaking, when we get the letters from you people home, we really appreciate it. We appreciate your views, and I think especially it's really warming to my heart when people that you can tell are really true wrestling fans that watch so much of it on the cable and on the satellites, and when they write a letter about how much they appreciate Mid-South and what they do by putting main events on the television and giving a full spectrum, I think it's outstanding. 2 minutes of television time remaining here today. Been an exciting time, boy.
Bill, as I was looking back in that other match, the great fans they can at the arenas can learn from these fans here on Mid-South on our television tapings during the Ted DiBiase match. They vented their wrath against DiBiase as they went from one to the other, hollering, Dugan, Dugan, and then two, 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 and JYD. That clap holler all you want to, but making the big extravaganzas this spring, we have two or three cowards in any of these big places and these big crowds, and they always have to throw something, and that's really hiding behind a big crowd. So they need to do like these fans, vent their wrath by putting their hands together, clapping, hollering, whatever they want to do, but not throw anything, because that is very cowardice.
Well, boy, I really appreciate your comments. You know, I think you're right and you're brave to say it. A lot of people don't want to go against public opinion, but you're certainly right, because generally, so many times it misses the individual it's thrown at and hits some innocent bystander. And I think, too, that if I was wrestling somebody out there, I want to be able to beat him on my own. I don't want somebody from the crowd to help me. If the crowd has to help me, I want to go sit in the crowd and buy a ticket to see that guy up there wrestling, because I signed the match and I got in there of my own free will, and I want the victory to the win or lose it by myself. And I think that's the way most of these athletes feel. If they can be outsmarted or outfigured. One, two, three, and we have one here. We have one here. Tony Zane wins the match, his first on Mid-South. And again, in this final 30 seconds, Boyd, I think what we'll say is that if I can be outsmarted or outwitted or outnumbered or outthought out there by an opponent, that's his right as an American, because I signed that contract getting in. I'll guarantee you, besides getting mad, I'm going to get even. And I think Hacksaw Dugan showed that there's always a way to balance it out, but it should be left among the contestants.
And the best way is the American way. Thank you so much for tuning in. Till next week for Cowboy Bill Watts, I'm your host, Boyd Pierce, saying goodbye, everybody, from Mid-South Wrestling Television Network.